Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Act of Leadership, a playbook for leading with humility, clarity, and purpose. Written and narrated by me, Dan Haesler. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to visual elements present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Disclaimer. The material in this publication is of the nature of general comment only and does not represent professional advice. It is not intended to provide specific guidance for particular circumstances, and it should not be relied on as the basis for any decision to take action or not take action on any matter which it covers. Readers should obtain professional advice where appropriate before making any such decision. To the maximum extent permitted by law, the author and publisher disclaim all responsibility and liability to any person arising directly or indirectly from any person taking or not taking action based on the information in this publication. Introduction. If I were to ask you what a good leader looks like and what they do and how they make you feel, you could probably tell me. Hopefully, you could name one or two of them from your own experience in the workplace. And if I asked you what a poor leader looks like, what they do, how they make you feel, again, you could tell me. You might be able to name one or two or three. You might even have nicknames for them, and you certainly have stories about them that you tell at dinner parties to try and one-up your friends about who has the worst boss. So why is it that, in the cold light of day, perhaps when you're perusing the business section of a bookstore, you're quite clear on what good leadership is, but in the heat of the day-to-day running of your team, you sometimes act more like the leader people talk about at dinner parties? As I see it, there are three main reasons for this, two more easily addressed than the other one. Reason one, you're human. This is the one that's not as easy to address, but we'll give it a go in part one of this book. Reason two, the way you've learned about leadership. We'll address this in parts two and three. And reason three, you don't do the things you've learned. This book is aimed at helping you to take what you've learned and use it to form new habits and, where necessary, break old ones. A few years ago, I was contracted by the National Rugby League, the NRL, in Australia, to present workshops to teams across the competition. My workshop was aimed at exploring the leadership links between mindset, habits, and performance. It was deliberately designed so that players, coaches, the backroom staff, and players' partners could relate to it either on a professional or personal level. A couple of days after presenting to the playing group at one club, my phone rang. It was the club's welfare officer telling me how the senior players in particular had loved it, and that the captain of the club, a state of origin representative, was insistent that the club engage me over the course of the upcoming season. In the skipper's words, what I had presented was the missing link. And now the welfare officer was telling me, mate, we want you to ourselves. Not only is this stuff good for them as people, the boys think this will give them the competitive edge over the rest of the comp. Mate, we want to put you in one of our jerseys. I was buzzing. However, the head coach, who didn't take part in my session, wanted to meet me to get a better idea of what a long-term engagement might look like. As with most NRL clubs, the head coach is the one whose opinion really matters. And I was excited as I drove to the club's headquarters because I'd heard this coach was a good guy and, given the captain and the senior players were keen to get going, I felt this meeting could only go well. I set about explaining some of my approaches and the rationale behind them, as I'll do in this book, and why any group of people striving towards a common aim might benefit from adopting them. The club's director of football, a highly regarded member of the rugby league community, was also in the meeting, and I was pleased to see him nodding along enthusiastically as I made my pitch. How well is this going? I thought to myself. Not that well, as it turned out. My pitch did nothing to convince the coach that his captain, senior players, or the welfare officer were on the right track. As he told me politely, yeah, I know all this. And besides, we already have someone come in once every couple of months or so to do this stuff with us. That was essentially all he said, and it was clearly the conclusion of the meeting. I left somewhat deflated, and it was no surprise when a day or so later, the club's welfare officer contacted me to confirm what I already knew. The club wouldn't be pursuing the engagement. I found myself reflecting on two things in particular over the ensuing days. Had I been too confident walking into that meeting? Was I less than fully prepared? Yes and yes. Not a great combination. I had assumed that because the senior players and the captain were championing my work, the coach would recognise the obvious benefit to having me on board. I was annoyed because I pride myself on my preparation and attention to detail. So to walk out of this meeting knowing that I hadn't prepared for anything other than a positive outcome rankled me somewhat. But I was also left reflecting on what the coach had said. He had told me he knew it all, and that they do this stuff every couple of months with someone from outside the club. Now, this isn't meant to sound like sour grapes, but he was illustrating the three reasons for poor leadership that I highlighted. Reason one, he's human. As a human, his confidence in knowing everything perhaps blinded him to the effectiveness or otherwise of what they were currently doing. Reason two, the way he'd learned about leadership, the manner in which they did this stuff once every couple of months or so, spoke to how he viewed learning as an event and only when an external consultant came in. Reason three, he doesn't do what he has learned. The coach would have learned that it's important to listen to his people, but clearly he wasn't doing that because he seemed oblivious to the fact that his players and backroom staff clearly didn't feel they were doing it anyway. Leadership isn't something you know. It's something you show. All the time. Had I been better prepared for our meeting, I might have been able to articulate these counterpoints in a respectful way. But I wasn't. So I didn't. 6 months later, the coach left the club amid claims he had lost the playing group. Obviously, I can't say that if I'd been engaged by the club, things would have been different. There would have been numerous complex issues at play. But in the years since that meeting with the coach, I've spent many hours working with all kinds of leaders from all walks of life, and I've had the opportunity to reflect on some of the reasons people don't quite have a handle on what it means to lead their people. I've researched the common challenges that leaders deal with, as well as the theories that explain why these challenges arise. And crucially, I've worked side by side with leaders and their teams as they've applied these theories to enhance how they live and work. I've also had the chance to dive deeper into these theories with some of the world's prominent leadership thinkers for my podcast, Habits of Leadership. So now I'm offering the world another leadership book. To be honest, I'm not even sure the world needs another leadership book. I said as much to the publishers in our earliest conversations and then realised that's probably not the way to go, so I quickly changed tack. In the traditional sense, this isn't another leadership book. Most books delve into one or two concepts, while this book seeks to cover a lot of ground in a short amount of time. It's a playbook of sorts for busy leaders, with an emphasis on helping them create new habits and ways of being in their day-to-day leadership that they can enact almost immediately. Here's a rundown of what you'll gain from this book. Part one tackles the you stuff and asks you to reflect on how do I show up? We'll explore some of the common challenges you face as a leader purely because you're human. Chapter 1. Is this the book for you? What kind of leader do you want to be? We'll look at some of the common archetypes used to describe leaders and leadership. You'll be challenged to reflect on which, if any, apply to you. And then I'll suggest some of the key takeaways each archetype might get from the book. Chapter 2. Be mindful, not mindless. The importance of being in the moment. We'll explore some of the fundamental human behaviours and responses that govern our day-to-day experiences. You'll be encouraged to consider mindfulness as the act of being deliberate and intentional. As much as we'll discuss breathing techniques, we'll keep circling back to the notion of acting mindfully as opposed to mindlessly. Chapter 3. Assume nothing, the biases that stop you from seeing what's really there. We'll look at some of the common cognitive biases that affect how we view ourselves and our impact on others, and address recency bias, blind spot bias, and the Dunning-Kruger effect. My goal in this chapter is to encourage you to rethink how you think. Chapter 4. How to turn it around. Why you don't learn from your mistakes. We'll address mindset and how it affects behaviour, particularly around changing your behaviour as a result of a setback. This chapter serves to set up parts 2 and 3 of the book by encouraging you to adopt a mindset that will allow you to get the most out of the subsequent chapters. Part 2 addresses the you and them stuff, with a particular focus on creating and nurturing environments in which you and your team do your best work. Chapter 5, Mum Was Wrong. It really does matter what others think of you. We'll seek to address why 360 feedback surveys rarely have the impact they should, as well as making the case that the best people to determine whether or not you're an effective leader are the people you lead, you'll be presented with a practical and attractive way to engage more of your team in your leadership development. Chapter 6. Make it safe to stuff up. High performance is not about being perfect. We'll help you understand the essential and often missing ingredient needed for teams to be high performing. This chapter will help you create a culture where risk-taking is welcome and where there is permission for candor that allows all voices to be heard and valued, particularly when those voices are saying something you might otherwise not want to hear. Yes, you heard that right. Chapter 7. Less carrot, less stick. Find out what makes people tick. We'll delve into the world of motivation and explore how leaders can empower the people they lead to authentically engage in their work. Chapter 8. Be better at change. Stop trying to get people on the bus. Exploring why attempts at individual and organizational change fail, and how you can avoid the common roadblocks, we'll tackle the issue of employee engagement through the lens of organizational change. Chapter 9. Less is more. Create space so your team can step up. We'll seek to help you become more coach-like and empower you to empower your teams. This chapter will show you how to adopt more coach-like techniques in your everyday interactions, rather than just viewing coaching as an event. Part 3 addresses the tactical stuff and provides advice for dealing with some of the most common challenges you might face on a day-to-day basis in your role as a leader. Chapter 10, Stop Wasting People's Time, Running Meetings That Matter. We'll discuss how to run better meetings so you actually get stuff done. Enough said. Chapter 11, No More Shit Sandwiches. Have better one-to-ones with your team. We'll explore why most of the feedback we're given doesn't have the cut-through the feedback giver was hoping for. Ever since school, we've ignored or made excuses as to why we don't need to take on feedback. This chapter challenges the common wisdom around the popular positive, constructive, or negative, positive approach to giving feedback, because it's wrong, and introduces you to the shift model for conversations. This tried and tested model can be deployed in virtually any setting and enacts all of the theory of the previous 10 chapters. Chapter 12, Have Less Difficult Conversations. Start having adult ones instead. We'll tackle one of the most common challenges we see for leaders, the art of having difficult conversations. The two main reasons people don't like these are that they don't like confrontation or they don't want to risk the relationship. This chapter will demonstrate that even conversations that are related to poor performance need not be confrontational and can indeed build relationships. It will give you the skills to empower people to take more ownership of their work. Conclusion. Roger Federer still feels the need for a coach, and you don't? Seriously? We'll encourage leaders to reflect on the fact that change is hard, and even the best in the world in their field usually have some form of coach. For those leaders not keen to engage with a coach, I provide a reflection and action journal to help leaders identify their growth opportunities and then self-regulate in their attempts to embed their learning from the book in their own context. Each chapter is intended to serve as a coaching session that identifies a prevalent leadership challenge and explores the research, theories, and concepts to help you address it. You'll be encouraged to reflect on what each chapter means for you personally and for your team by using my coaching lens of developing insights, intentions, and actions. Too often, we might only develop one or two of the three necessary elements to affect positive change. The sweet spot of coaching is where we use insights to motivate ourselves to act in a new way that, as well as improving performance, provides us with new insights. You'll be asked to reflect on the sweet spot at the end of each chapter. Importantly, each chapter also presents an act of leadership, where I'll share with you some strategies and techniques, and in some cases, even words to say, in order for you to enhance your leadership to address the challenges you've identified. For those who want to dig deeper into the specific concepts, this book serves as a gateway to other books written by world-leading authorities in their field. I've been fortunate to chat with the authors of some of these books, and so I'm able to add further insights as to how their thinking informs the practical strategies I use every day with clients. You can also access tools, further resources, and full podcast interviews with the people mentioned in the book at www.activeleadership.com. With the exception of the publicly recognizable identities in this book, the names and nature of the organizations of the people I use in the case studies have been changed in the interests of privacy. Had I written this book 3 years ago, I might have left a copy with the coach for him to flick through, and maybe, just maybe, he might not have lost the playing group or his job. Part 1. The you stuff. Let's explore some of the challenges you face as a leader purely because you're human. Chapter 1. Is this the book for you? What kind of leader do you want to be? This chapter in a nutshell. You'll be introduced to the prominent thinking around leadership theories and styles. You'll be encouraged to reflect on how these theories and styles inform your own leadership. You'll see how each chapter of this book might help you enhance your leadership. Why this book? Why not the one sitting beside it in the store? Maybe it was given to you as a gift, and you're still trying to figure out whether or not to invest your time in it. I get it. You're busy, and you don't want to waste time with a book that isn't for you. This chapter helps you ascertain whether or not this book can help you, and how it might be able to help you. You will chart a course that might mean you flick through some chapters quicker than others, or you might choose to focus on just one or two. In essence, I'm trying to write in a similar manner to how I coach. Not everyone needs everything, and some people only need one thing. Rather than tell you something, let me start by asking you something. What kind of leader do you want to be? Take some time to ponder, and then note down what comes to mind for you. Look back over what you wrote and consider. Was it easy to answer that question? Did you focus on your ability to deliver results based on products, processes, policies, or people? Did you compare yourself to others? Are they well-known leaders or people only you would know? Does anything you wrote surprise you? Have you ever taken time to consider this question before? Where have you gone looking for answers? Have you looked for a mentor or just taken your lead from what you think the organization expects? How satisfied are you with your leadership right now? If you had to score yourself out of 10 as a leader, what would you say? How inclined are you to want to improve? By the way, if you scored yourself a 10, this is either not the book for you or, more likely, absolutely the book for you. And I'm guessing perhaps it was given to you as a gift. Now, unlike at school, when teachers used to lie and tell you there are no right or wrong answers, when it comes to these questions, and in fact, any questions I ask as a coach, we're not as interested in the notion of right and wrong as we are in what it brings up for you. What new awareness can we create from asking questions of ourselves and each other? Coaching, and this book, is not a test. Your answers and thoughts are yours alone, and a piece of paper can't judge, criticize, or hold anything against you. So whenever I ask you to reflect, the more open and honest you can be with yourself, the more awareness you'll create. Are you up for that? If so, this might be the book for you. But back to that question. What kind of leader do you want to be? In my experience, some people struggle to answer the question because they haven't spent enough time thinking about leadership and what it really means to be a leader. In many cases, people find themselves in a position of leadership by default, or as a result of being the last one standing, or in some cases being tapped on the shoulder and given an opportunity. I've lost count of the number of people I've worked with who say, "I never set out for this," or "I never thought of myself as a leader." Sometimes this is an indication of their humility, but more often than not, it's also a sign that they've unexpectedly found themselves in a position of leadership and they're still trying to figure out whether they're really the right person for the job. Imposter syndrome is quite common among leaders, but fear not. As the host of Coaching for Leaders, Dave Stachowiak, says, leaders aren't born, they're made. With a little reflection and deliberate action, you can become a great leader. When working with a leader for the first time, rather than jumping straight into what needs to be fixed or improved, I found it useful to spend time exploring the concept of leadership with them, and I'd like to do that with you now. So, what makes a good leader? Several well-established theories and styles form our understanding of leadership and what good leadership looks like. While I won't cover them all here, it might be helpful to dig into some of the more prominent ones at this point. For a time, it was thought that leadership was something that either came naturally or didn't. You're either a natural leader or you weren't. It's likely that this thinking came from observing the natural world, in which we recognise leadership in a pack as being dependent on inherent traits. The biggest, strongest, or loudest tend to lead, while the smaller, the weaker, quieter tend to follow. And while that might work in the Serengeti, the Daintree rainforest, or local woodland, we've come to learn that leadership is more nuanced in the human world of organisations and communities. That said, it can be useful to analyse the apparent traits that successful leaders possess. While not being an exhaustive list, some of the more immediately recognisable domains are knowledge, emotional intelligence, confidence, honesty, energy, likability, decision-making skills, and flexibility. The question here is, to what extent do you feel you can improve in each of these domains? If you adopt a mindset of you either have it or you don't, you're susceptible to what Professor Carol Dweck describes as a fixed mindset. We'll explore this in more detail in Chapter 4, but broadly speaking, if you hold a fixed mindset around your leadership, you believe that if you're a natural leader, there's no need to learn how to improve. Well, if you believe you aren't a natural leader, then you see no point trying to improve. You simply don't have what it takes. The good news is that there is also the growth mindset approach. As I mentioned, we'll dig into what mindset theories mean to you in Chapter 4, but right now, I'd like you to take a moment to consider the domains I listed and what they mean to you. And remember, there are no right or wrong answers. Knowledge. How much do you know about your organisation, its processes, its people, and its objectives? Is more knowledge always a good thing for you in your position? Do you know enough? How might you find out more about the things you really need to know? Emotional intelligence. To what extent are you able to recognise and manage your emotions? Are you able to recognise and manage the emotions of others? To what extent can you read a room, or do you sometimes miss the mark? Confidence. How confident are you in your abilities? Does this confidence alter if you compare your confidence in your ability to get the job done versus your confidence in getting others to do a job? Are you confident in front of a group, or do you have the confidence to handle tricky conversations in one-to-one meetings? How do you distinguish between confidence, ego, and arrogance? Honesty. How honest can you be with your people? Do they need to know everything? Is transparency always a good thing? Is there such a thing as being too honest? Do you ever find yourself needing to be brutally honest with someone? Energy. How much energy do you bring to your role? What kind of energy do you bring? Do you brighten or energize a room by walking in? Or do you get the impression that maybe you brighten up the room by walking out? Likeability. How important is it to you that your people like you? Do you ever find yourself holding back on an issue because of your desire to be liked? Alternatively, is your mantra, "I'm not here to be liked, I'm here to do a job"? decision-making skills. Are you quick to make decisions, or do you like to take your time? Do you need the input of as many people as possible, or do you trust your own instincts? Do you have the confidence to pull the trigger, or do you tend to second-guess yourself and procrastinate? Flexibility. Is it your way or the highway, or do you tend to sway with the group? Do you hold fast on a decision, or you constantly review it? Do you give your people free range to go about their work however they wish, or is there a strict process you ensure they adhere to? Now let me guess your answer to each of those domains. It depends. And of course, it depends. In fact, it depends is usually my answer to any question I get in a workshop or Q&A panel. And while some people might feel this is a cop-out, rather, it recognises that life is complex and often issues have nuances that are context-specific and temporal. The important follow-up questions are, on what? And then, how does that play out? Taking the hits for the team. I was consulting with Anya at a large manufacturing company. Over the previous 12 months, she'd been promoted internally to the position of National Head of Sales. She was now in charge of the people she used to work side by side with. I'd been invited in because Anya hadn't made as productive a start in a new role as her boss would have liked. That's not to say she was doing a bad job. In fact, her team thought she was very supportive and an improvement on her predecessor. So what was going on? We were having our initial chat over a cup of coffee at a cafe in the industrial park where the company was based. Leaving aside Anya's choice of coffee, decaf soy latte, not a coffee, we got off to a good start. I heard about how Anya had been the first in her family to go to university, and she seemed to be on the fast track to corporate success as her appointment to National Head of Sales had come relatively quickly. In fact, as we chatted, I started to think that perhaps I was meeting with the wrong person. Anya was sharp, knew her stuff, and seemed to be pretty well read on leadership. But then it happened. Just as we were wrapping up, and I was preparing to go back to the organisation to find out who I was supposed to be working with next, Anya received a text message. She let out a sigh and said, "Sorry, Dan, are we done? I have to get back. Something's come up and the team can't sort it out without me. It's the third time this year." It was February. I tagged along as Anya went back to rescue the situation. Evidently, a customer had a complaint and Anya was the only one they wanted to speak to. On the surface, not such an issue, but what transpired was quite interesting. Over the past few months, Anya had taken to dealing with any complaints that came across the sales team's desk. She was great at diffusing situations and ensuring customer loyalty. The team loved this, of course, because it meant they didn't have to deal with the worst aspects of their job and saw Anya as taking the hits for the team. But now it was apparent. This is how to deal with complaints. Pass them to Anya. I realised that I had met with the right person and I started prepping for our next conversation. You can probably already draw the lines between the various domains and the predicament Anya found herself in. If Anya was reflecting on the domains mentioned previously, her confidence and likability reflection might sound like this. Anya. Well, it depends. Me? On what? If we're hitting our numbers or not? If we need to keep this customer at all costs? And how does that play out? Well, I'm confident handling tricky customers, but I'm not sure about others. It's just easier and safer to do it myself. And how does that play out? In the short term, pretty well, like we keep the sale. But I know my team aren't developing, and what's worse, they like me for it. Anya had found herself in what I call the leader's quandary, where leaders find themselves too busy doing other people's work, yet feel they can't address it for fear of losing the team. Over time, leaders find themselves exhausted and exasperated, asking, why can't they just do their jobs? The minute you notice your team aren't developing is the minute you realise you've stopped leading. Are there any times you've been faced with the leader's quandary? Hint, these are the times when you found yourself saying, oh, don't worry, it'll only take me 5 minutes. Why don't they get it? Or, it'll be quicker if I just do it myself. The key takeaway here is that these dispositions alone will not guarantee your success as a leader, because leadership is about others. But they can serve as a conversation starter as you learn to adopt and adapt them to enhance your leadership. With great power comes great responsibility. I'm not sure who said it first, but I do know that Uncle Ben said it to Peter Parker in the 2002 Spider-Man movie. And even though this is a popular social quote, it certainly holds. It's impossible to lead without power or influence, but I'm assuming you haven't been bitten by a radioactive spider. So from where do you draw your power or influence? One of the most well-known theories of power and influence is that of John French and Bertram Raven, in which they state that forms of power and influence are divided into two categories, positional and personal. Let's deal with positional power first. Positional power. Within this category, there are four types of power: legitimate, reward, coercive, and informational. Legitimate power. Legitimate power comes from being in a position of power in any organization, such as the manager in a smaller organization and the role of a CEO in a broader organization. This type of power is dependent on the individual holding that position and on the hierarchies within organizations and communities. For example, should your manager lose their job, they no longer have the power to tell you when you can take leave. Or while a prime minister might be able to introduce laws in their country, they are largely powerless to do the same in another. However, their position might allow them some influence. Reward power. Reward power is primarily extended through setting rewards for individuals who are able to complete their set targets. Whether it's stickers for a child completing their homework or a multi-figure bonus for a CEO meeting their targets, this type of power is often used to encourage individuals to work harder with the promise of a reward if they do so. As we explore in Chapter 8, an over-reliance on the extrinsic motivators required for reward power can actually serve to undermine productivity, team cohesion, and your leadership in the long term. Coercive power. If reward power has its drawbacks, then you need to be mindful of coercive power. The use or abuse of coercive power can include inducing a fear of losing employment, receiving a negative performance report, or the threat of being demoted and having perks taken away. It's not uncommon for leaders and organizations to rely too heavily on coercive power, especially when trying to establish high performance standards and expectations from employees. As we explore in Chapter 6, these attempts are often misguided, and while the need for consequences for poor performance is self-evident, an over-reliance on coercive power often creates lower standards and, in the worst cases, a toxic work environment. Informational power. You know that whole "I know a secret" feeling that you had when you were a kid? That's informational power. It's having control over information that others need or want that puts you in a powerful position. You might know people who carry themselves differently when they know something you don't. They come out of a meeting and they want you to know that they know something you don't. It's a classic power play that ultimately damages teams. Today, in what is often referred to as the knowledge or information economy, having access to information is particularly powerful. But what's more powerful is what you do with it. Think of how many times terms like fake news have been used over the past few years, or cases of insider trading have hit the headlines. Within your own organization, it might be smaller issues like who's up for the new position of regional manager, or who's going to keep or lose their jobs in the next round of budget cuts. In its best form, informational power can be used to help and empower people. In its worst, it can be used as a weapon. When it comes to power and influence, French and Raven suggest relying purely on positional power is fraught with challenges. You may well have had experiences working with people who did just that. We don't want to be like them. Personal power. The second category is personal power. French and Raven identify two types of personal power: expert and referent. Expert power. Expert power stems from personal experiences, knowledge, or skill set. With increasing experience across a particular field, we're able to become leaders in that space. Becoming a subject matter expert gives us a level of expert power because we're able to think a situation through and suggest solutions. You might know people who are the go-to person in your organisation around various issues. Referent power. This power comes from being revered. Rightly or wrongly, some people have the trust of many. This is one reason why you see many politicians clamouring for the support of celebrities. The public don't trust pollies, but they do trust their favourite musician. And if they say the politician's all right, then that's good enough for them. The challenge for leaders is not to rely on referent power overly. Otherwise, they end up in Anya's situation of not wanting to be disliked, and that fear paralyses the leader from making the decisions they need to make. The reality is, there's no secret solution to leadership. There's no one-size-fits-all approach. It's a continuous cycle of having an awareness of the scenario, deciding if something needs to be addressed, and, if so, doing something that will address the situation and ideally create new awareness. So with that in mind, when it comes to how you use your power, have you taken Uncle Ben's advice to heart? Do you use it responsibly? Where does your power as a leader come from? What do you need to be more aware of? What's your style? So far, we've considered some theories. Now let's consider how this plays out in your actions. You've likely heard of Kurt Lewin's leadership styles framework: autocratic, democratic, and laissez-faire. And while there are many other styles we could consider, this provides us with a good starting point in determining which elements of this book are going to be of most use for you. The framework defined by Lewin presents different leadership styles with variations specifically around decision-making and management. Autocratic style. If you're an autocratic leader, you're keen to make your own decisions. In making these decisions, you're often detached from and don't require any form of consultation with your team. Sometimes these decisions are based on the personal opinion of the leader and are imposed across the organisation. This style of leadership is considered appropriate when there is no need.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Playbooks, use the link in the video description.